It's a pleasure to be back with my church here at Verroaks. I haven't been here since before Christmas, so Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. My name is Graham Gundon. I'm an intern here for the Rock Moss Ministry Associates Scheme. Been here a member for about 4 years, so most of you probably know me. But if you don't, I'd love to get to know you, so come introduce yourself to me after the service. We're going to be looking today at Isaiah chapter 44 and the beginning of chapter 45. So please turn in your Bible to Isaiah chapter 44 in verse 21. That's page 605 in the Pew Bibles, and please stand for the reading of God's Word. Remember these things, O Jacob, and Israel, for you are my servant. I formed you, you are my servant. O Israel, you will not be forgotten by me. I have blotted out your transgressions like a cloud, and your sins like mist. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. Sing, O heavens, for the Lord has done it. Shout, O depths of the earth. Break forth into singing, O mountains, O forests and every tree in it. For the Lord has redeemed Jacob and will be glorified in Israel. Thus says the Lord your Redeemer, who formed you from the womb. I am the Lord who made all things, who alone stretched out the heavens, who spread out the earth by myself, who frustrates the signs of liars and makes fools of diviners, who turns wise men back and makes their knowledge foolish, who confirms the word of his servant and fulfills the counsel of his messengers, who says of Jerusalem, she shall be inhabited, and of the cities of Judah they shall be built, and I will raise up their ruins, who says to the deep, be dry, I will dry up your rivers, who says of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and he shall fulfill all my purpose, saying of Jerusalem, she shall be built, and of the temple your foundation shall be laid. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him, and to loose the belts of kings, to open doors before him, that gates may not be closed. I will go before you and level the exalted places. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness, and the hordes in secret places, that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob, and Israel my chosen, I call you by your name. I name you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I equip you, though you do not know me, that people may know, from the rising of the sun and from the west, that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all these things. Shower, O heavens, from above, and let the clouds rain down righteousness. Let the earth open, that salvation and righteousness may bear fruit. Let the earth cause them both to sprout. I, the Lord, have created it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you in adoration and in gratitude for bringing us here together as your redeemed people. Lord, we thank you for the word that you have given to us. Lord, that you reveal yourself to us through it, that you give us truth and light through it. Lord, I pray that as I preach your word to your people, that our faith may be strengthened, that our hearts might be convicted and encouraged and comforted by the power of your Spirit. I pray that you would speak through me by the power of your Spirit, and that your people would hear your words by the power of your Spirit. I pray these all in Jesus' name. Amen. So, by way of introduction, it's necessary to know the historical context for what's going on here in Isaiah 44 and 45. And as we've been going through Isaiah, we've seen Isaiah speaking to the people of Judah and telling them God's messages to them, God's words to them. And Isaiah has ministered through and has had a mission to the people of Judah through the reign of four kings. And now we are in the reign of Hezekiah, the king of Judah, and probably coming towards the end of Hezekiah's reign. And this here is a speech from God to Judah through the prophet Isaiah. At this point in Judah's history and in Israel's history, It's a relatively peaceful time. Assyria, the empire of Assyria, had come up against Jerusalem and laid siege to it, but the Lord had driven them back. And right now, Hezekiah's reign is a reign of relative peace. But Isaiah, as he prophesies about the coming future for the people of God, he prophesies that because of their sin, because of their rebellion and their idolatry, they will be sent into exile. He prophesies about the empire of Babylon and how they will come and they will besiege Jerusalem and they will lay waste to Jerusalem and they will carry them off into captivity. So this prophecy here takes place about 100 years before the exile, before all of those things happen. And the speech is meant to communicate at least two things to the people of Israel, to God's people. First, that though they are to go into exile, it is certain that they will go into exile. Their redemption is also certain. So when they get down the road 100 years from now, and they are in exile, and Babylon has taken them out of the promised land, they can look to the promises of God and know that they will be redeemed. The second thing that this speech is meant to communicate is the goal of redemption. And the goal of redemption is the glory of God. And they may seem like two relatively unrelated points, but they actually are very connected. And I hope that becomes more clear as we dig into the text. And so as we read through this, I want us to see three specific things. First, the certainty of redemption. Second, the means of redemption. And third, the goal of redemption. So if we look at verses 21 through 23, verse 21 says, "Remember these things, O Jacob and Israel, for you are my servant. I formed you, you are my servant. O Israel, you will not be forgotten by me." So God here identifies his people using two names. Their traditional name, Israel, is what they were called by the nations around them, is what they were called by the prophets, and what they were called by God. Traditionally, most commonly. But then he also refers to them as Jacob. So he's not referring to two different people. He's referring to one people, two names, Israel and Jacob. And when the people of Israel hear the name Jacob, and when they are called Jacob, they immediately hearken back to the time of the patriarchs, and specifically to Jacob and the story of Jacob. And this helps Israel, as they go into exile, to have certainty in the redemption that is theirs in God, because God is not just arbitrarily choosing to redeem them at this point in history. God has chosen Israel, God has chosen Jacob as his people hundreds of years before this ever happened. And in fact, the redemption of Israel was God's plan all along. And there are promises that help Judah, help Israel to realize that they are God's chosen people and they will be redeemed by God. And if we look at the story of Jacob and his brother Esau, we see Jacob and Esau were twins. Esau was born first, though, so he was the eldest brother, and he was the one that was to inherit all the things from his father, and he was to be the chosen son. He was to be the son of God. But God actually chose Jacob, the younger son, in the womb instead. And it's interesting that he chooses him in the womb rather than after they're born, because in the womb there was nothing that Jacob could have done to merit this choice of God. If we look down in verse 24, it says, "Thus the Lord, your Redeemer, who formed you from the womb, I am the Lord who made all things, who alone stretched out the heavens, who spread out the earth by himself." And so just like Jacob was formed and chosen in the womb of his mother, so the nation of Israel was formed and chosen before they could do anything to merit their own choosing, before they could do anything to merit this redemption that is going to be provided for them. And they were in the plan of God long before this exile ever happened. So since the beginning, God had been watching over and caring for Israel, despite the fact that they lacked any sort of merit. And in fact, in spite of the fact that they had no merit. Also, in verse 21, God commands Israel to remember that they will not be forgotten by God. And this is especially shocking given the fact that they will be in exile. The whole city of Jerusalem, the promised city of God, Mount Zion, will be leveled. the temple, the dwelling place of God, will be destroyed, and all of them will be taken off into captivity out of the promised land into a strange land. And God commands them, remember, O Israel, you will not be forgotten by me. It's amazing in the providence of God that before, 100 years before the exile even happens, he's making a way for the Israelites to see that they have every reason to be confident in their salvation in God. And it's interesting that the reason for Israel's exile into Babylon wasn't just, you know, something that happened by mere happenstance and, you know, Babylon wanted to take over Palestine, so they bring them off into captivity. No. If we read all the way from Deuteronomy up to Isaiah, the whole history of Israel is a history of rebellion, of idolatry, of injustice. And God warns them at the very inception of the nation at Mount Sinai. He says, if you fall into these sins, if you become an idolatrous nation, if you do not obey my law, you will be destroyed. You will be carried off into exile. And then he warns them over and over and over again through his prophets that if you continue in these sinful ways, you will be destroyed. So the reason for Israel's rebellion, the reason for their exile, was rebellion. Don't you hate it when horrible things happen to you? It's always a difficult thing to deal with, and that can be everything from a car accident to the death of a loved one in the family. It's always a difficult thing to deal with, but it's always especially difficult when it's your fault, or when it happens as a result of your sin, or a result of my sin. I mean, you just think about getting in a car wreck. You know, I've been in car wrecks where it wasn't my fault, and I've been in car wrecks where it was my fault. And when it's not my fault, it's a lot easier to deal with the situation. But when I know it is my fault, it makes it a lot more tough. And for Israel, it's their fault that they're going into exile. It's because of their sin that they're going into exile. And this is why the words of verse 22 are so poignant and so comforting for Israel. I have blotted out your transgressions like a cloud and your sins like mist. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. So even though the exile is a result of their own sin, even though it would feel like we have to remedy this ourselves because we're the ones that got ourselves in this mess in the first place, God reminds them, I have done away with your sins. Your sins have been blotted out like the sun of the Middle East blots out mist. They're gone. And he commands them then, because of this redemption, to return to him. And so this redemption is what motivates them, it's what drives them, it's what gives them the desire to return to him. And for us, it's the same thing. The redemption that we have received in Christ is what motivates us, what gives us the desire to return to God. But not only that, it's the only means by which we can return to God. God does not deal with sin in his presence. And that includes sinful people. We must be redeemed. Our sins must be cleansed for us to be able to return to God at all. So Israel was not just arbitrarily made God's people at the time of the exile. They were his people from the beginning, and their redemption was planned from the beginning. Not because of their own virtue, but because of the purposes of God. Look at verses 24 through 28. Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, who formed you from the womb. I am the Lord who made all things, who alone stretched out the heavens, who spread out the earth by myself, who frustrates the sign of liars and makes the fools of diviners, who turns wise men back and makes their knowledge foolish, who confirms the word of his servant and fulfills the counsel of his messengers, who says of Jerusalem, she shall be inhabited, and the cities of Judah, they shall be built, and I will raise up their ruins. And he begins this statement with, I am the Lord. Literally in the Hebrew, I am Yahweh, Ani Adonai. And this is repeated throughout the text, and it's very important. God is taking credit for this redemption. He's not Baal, he's not Ahasuerus, he's not Marduk. He is Yahweh, the one true God of Israel. And this prophecy here should also give Israel comfort and conviction that they will be redeemed because the Lord has said it. And interestingly, he draws a distinction between the pagans who try to foretell the future and then the prophets of God who deliver the message of the future from God. And he claims responsibility for frustrating the signs of pagans and false prophets. In the ancient Near East, they used to do weird things to be able to tell the future. They'd look for signs and omens. You know, you read a lot about the oracle at Delphi and, you know, confronting spirits and gods and being able to tell the future. And they would often feed pigs and goats and birds specific types of food, and then they would slaughter them and try to read their entrails to be able to tell what the future would be. And to us, that doesn't make a lot of sense, which is good, because to God, it doesn't make a lot of sense that they would do that either. It's impossible for them to tell the future. Those things didn't work. And even the scientific wise men who didn't give in to all that mumbo-jumbo about reading intestines and stuff like that, and who just tried to base their predictions of the future upon what is happening now and what has happened in the past, even them, God says literally here that the wise men are backwards. They don't know what they're talking about. Common wisdom doesn't always tell us what will happen in the future. And for the Israelite going off into exile, it would seem obvious. Our people are destroyed. We are no longer the chosen people of God. We are in exile. The temple's destroyed. There's no way that we can remain a nation now under God. But God does know the future. And there have been times when he has shared the future and his will with his people. And he does that now through Isaiah, and he's done that through his prophets throughout the whole Old Testament. But he not only knows the future, he directs it, he commands it. He commands that Jerusalem will be established here in verse 26. And in verse 27, very interestingly, it says, "He who says to the deep, 'Be dry,' I will dry up your rivers." So there will be a reversal of the exile. They will come back from exile. They will inhabit Jerusalem, and it will be on the scale of the Exodus from Egypt. When they walked through the Red Sea, when they crossed through the Jordan on dry ground into the Promised Land. So he is the creator. He is the one who knows and directs the future. And Israel can be certain of their redemption because God has ensured their future. And they can have confidence that when all seems lost, they will be redeemed. And so also, we can have confidence in our darkest times that God has not forgotten us, that he will redeem us. And really, that is the most important thing, isn't it? That your sins are blotted out, that your transgressions are wiped out, and that you are redeemed. So that is the certainty of redemption. Next, we move on to the means of redemption. And here, God is talking about his mighty acts, that he is the creator. He stretches out heaven, and he forms the foundations of the earth, and he creates everything in between. He is the creator, and he knows the future, and he directs the future. And here he comes to the pinnacle of his mighty acts. In verse 28, who says of Cyrus, "He is my shepherd, and he shall fulfill all my purpose," saying of Jerusalem, "She shall be built, and the temple, your foundation, will be laid." So Cyrus wasn't just like any other emperor or any other conqueror. He was really the hipster Alexander the Great. He was overthrowing empires before it was cool. And he was born around 570 BC, so this prophecy was... Cyrus was prophesied about 200 years before his own birth. This is one of the most specific prophecies in the whole Bible, that God calls Cyrus by name 200 years before his birth, before Persia was even a blip on the map. He was born around 570 BC, and at the time, Persia was just a small tribe in eastern modern-day Iran. And he inherited the kingdom from his father. Shortly thereafter, he overcomes and overthrows the Median Empire, that was ruled by his grandfather. The Median Empire becomes a part of his empire. He marches to modern-day Turkey, defeats one of the most wealthy empires that the world had ever seen, the Empire of Lydia. And then after that, he comes back down to Babylon and, without even drawing his sword, marches through the gates of Babylon and takes over the whole empire of Babylon and absorbs it into his kingdom. He was, and probably still is, one of the most impressive men that we have ever seen in history. He was a brilliant tactician, he was a master politician, an admirable leader, he was a benevolent ruler. He gave the people, this will just give you an example of how brilliant he was. When Babylon conquered people, they would bring them into captivity and they would take them out of their land so they couldn't incite rebellion where they lived. So they would disperse them throughout their empire. And when Cyrus came in and he took over and absorbed Babylon into his empire, he told all the people that had been conquered by Babylon, you can go back to your land, and you can take your gods with you, and you can set up your lives there under my rule freely. And so what do you think that does? It wins the loyalty of all those people, and they all go back to their land, and they're loyal to the king, the emperor of Persia. So he does the same exact thing with Israel. And this is actually how Israel is, the exile is reversed for Israel. Cyrus, this pagan king, this king who, it's said here over and over, you do not know me. God says to Cyrus, you do not know me. You do not know me. You are a pagan. You are not a worshiper of Yahweh. You are an idolater. But God uses him to bring Israel out of exile. It's amazing the things that God uses for our good, isn't it? And in our own political landscape today, it's especially pertinent. Israel had no gods to take back with them, though, because when the temple was destroyed, that was the house of God, and God was not an idol. God is the creator of the universe. So Cyrus says, you can go back to Jerusalem, you can rebuild Jerusalem, and guess what? I'm paying for you to rebuild the temple. Look at verses 1 through 4. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped to subdue nations before him and to loose the belts of kings, to open the doors before him, that gates may not be closed. I will go before you and level the exalted places. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and the hoards in secret places, that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel my chosen, I call you by your name. I name you, though you do not know me. Into history, it looks as if Cyrus had accomplished all of these things. He had radically changed the course of human history. But we know that it was God who actually accomplished these things through Cyrus. God called Cyrus 200 years before he was even born. And he anointed him, literally the word there, Messiah. Cyrus became a Messiah for the people of Israel. And he destroyed empires, and he raised up kingdoms, all for this tiny little nation of Israel. Our God is a powerful God, and he uses any means necessary in order to bring about redemption for his people. And of course, Cyrus does point to the true Messiah, doesn't he? As Cyrus is a Messiah that brings deliverance to Israel, so Christ is our true Messiah that brings deliverance to us. And he doesn't just rule an empire in the ancient Near East. He isn't a mortal man that is gone and is just a part of history. He is the eternal, everlasting king of all of creation. And he has accomplished our redemption. As we were in slavery under the bondage of sin, Christ has come in and he has liberated us and he has sent us back from our exile into the presence of God. So the certainty of our redemption in God's plan, the means of our redemption in Christ, as typified by Cyrus, and now the goal of redemption. I was reminded of the goal of redemption a few months ago as I was traveling for work. I came in contact with this man who was selling theology curriculum to Christian schools. And in our conversation, he asked me, why did Jesus come to earth? And of course, as a Bible college student, I was like, well, that's a ridiculous question. Of course, he came to earth to redeem his people. Any theology student can tell you that. And he looked at me rather disappointed, and he said, no, that's wrong. And he actually told me that the only reason I answered the question that way is because I'm obsessed with myself. And after being a little offended for a while, I realized that he's exactly right. The goal of redemption is actually not me. The goal of redemption is not you. The goal of redemption is actually the glory of God the Father. Jesus came to earth not merely to redeem his people, although he did come to earth to redeem his people, but he came to redeem his people for his Father's glory. Look at verse 5 and 6 of chapter 45. Here we see that phrase again. I am the Lord, Ani Adonai. I am Yahweh. And there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I equip you, Cyrus, though you do not know me, that people may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. The Lord anoints Cyrus to come and redeem his people. Why? That people may know from the rising of the sun from the east to the setting of the sun in the west, that all of creation can see that I am the Lord and there is no other. God uses Cyrus to conquer the world for the redemption of his people. Why? So that all would know that he is God. So that all would see his mighty acts, so that he would be glorified above all. Look back at chapter 43 in verse 25, just a page back. It says, I am he. Very similar language here. I am he. I am the Lord who blots out your transgressions. Why? For my own sake. And I will not remember your sins. This is why he saved Israel, for his own sake. This is why he has saved us. This is why he has saved me and you, for his own sake. It is not for our sake that we have received redemption. It is for God's sake. The man who was selling the theology curriculum who I had this conversation with, he pointed me to John 12, 27. And this is Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's praying before his crucifixion just the day before. And he says, John 12, 27 and 28. Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. Jesus says here explicitly, the reason why I have come to this earth, the reason why I have come to accomplish redemption is to glorify my Father in heaven. Romans 11, 33 through 36. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. So the purpose of redemption is not merely redemption. The purpose of redemption is that God would be glorified. This is a hard truth for us to accept sometimes. And the reason why it's a hard truth for us to accept, because when we think of God's plan for the world, we tend to think about it with us at the center. But God is at the center of his own plan in the world. We also have a problem, we tend to think about it, and we think it's a problem to think of God this way, that he would be so about himself. It seems selfish to us. It seems like he's just obsessed with himself. But the problem with that is we don't have a good distinction between the creator and the creature. We don't understand who God is and who we are ourselves. Of course, we're commanded to not be obsessed with ourselves because we're not all that great. We're creatures. Of course, we're commanded to not be obsessed with other people because they're not all that great. They're creatures. But God is the source of all goodness, truth, love, beauty, justice, perfection. And for him to not be obsessed with himself would be unrighteous. All glory rightly belongs to God. And he is the highest of all perfections. I remember I grew up in the Mennonite church, and in Sunday school, they used to teach us that, as a seven-year-old, you have those deep questions. Why did God create the earth? And we were told, well, before creation, God was lonely and he wanted to have creatures that he could spend time with and that he could love. And of course, I believed it as a 7-year-old, but as I grew older and I started to know the truth, it angered me, and it continues to anger me today, that I was taught that God lacks something, that God would have been lonely. That is not God. God lacks nothing. God needs nothing. He has always been completely satisfied in who he is in his own glory. And his glory is such that it tends to spill over and create new ways in which it can be magnified. And that is why God created the heavens and the earth. That's why he stretched out the heavens and formed the earth. It's a stage for his glory to be magnified in. And every aspect of creation screams the glory of God. All of history points to his beauty, and it will point to his beauty for eternity. If you want to turn to Revelation 5, verse 11, and this is at the end of redemption. Redemption has been accomplished. The saints are in heaven. And this is what's going on. Then I looked, and I heard around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Worthy is the Lamb who was what? Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. This is what ignites our praise and our worship of God, is the fact that he has redeemed us. And because he has redeemed us, he has a people now who praise his name for eternity. Yes, God is created in, or God is glorified in his creation. We look at the beauties of the ocean and mountains and our brothers and sisters and our husbands and wives, and we see the glory of God in all those things. And we should praise him for those things. But God is most glorified in the redemption of his people. And what is the redemption of his people? How is it that the redemption of his people was accomplished? But through the person, Jesus Christ. There's an elliptical aspect of this as well. Just as the redemption of his people is for the purpose of glorifying him, so those things that they must be redeemed from glorify him as well. Look at verse 7. I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all these things. Light and darkness, well-being, calamity. God creates those things. God is sovereign over all of those things. For Israel, as they go off into exile, yes, they go off into exile because it was their sin. Their sin led to that. But God is sovereign over that. God made that exile happen, and he is at work even in that exile that they might be redeemed. And many of us, we face calamity. We face the evils of the world constantly. My grandpa just passed away last night. But the most glorious thing and the most comforting thing about that is that God will be glorified even in that calamity. So what does this mean for us? First off, it's gratitude. We can be grateful to the one who has saved us. God saves us for his own sake. Why? That he might be magnified. And the more magnified he is, the more we see him and the more we delight in him, because he is the author of all perfection and he is the source of all joy. And what a tragedy it would be if God were modest and he didn't want to show us his greatness and he didn't want to exhibit his glory in all of redemption. So it leads to our praise and our gratitude for who God is, that he gives us the opportunity to be a part of that glory and to rejoice in who he is. Second, it gives us certainty of redemption. Just like Israel was sent off into exile, and they knew that they would be brought back because of God's promises in the past and that God foretold that they will be brought back from exile. The greatest certainty that we have with the promise of redemption is that God is all about his glory. And he is most glorified when he redeems his people. God will redeem us because his own honor and his own glory is at stake. Thirdly, the redemption that he has provided us for us in his son, the true Messiah, should ignite our praises for him. We should desire to praise him all the more. We should desire to come to with God's people at church on Sunday or throughout the week. We should desire to come together to praise God because God has redeemed us. As we meditate upon our salvation, the man Jesus Christ and what he has done for us, the glory of God that is made manifest in him, the more we should delight in him and so praise him more and more. You know, when we really enjoy things, we talk about those things a lot. Like, if you really enjoy your work, you'll talk about your work often. I'm from Michigan. I think Michigan is the most beautiful state in the union. And if you want to talk to me about Michigan, I'll talk about Michigan all day long because I love Michigan. I think it's beautiful. I think it's a great place to live. We have great beaches. Even this time of year, you know, you get ice fishing and stuff. Because I like Michigan. I like being in Michigan. Michigan is a good place to me. On such a so much more of a greater level, how much do you desire God? How much do you enjoy God in seeing his work in redemption? That's why it should ignite our praise. That's why it should be something that we enjoy doing. And when we come to church on Sunday, we worship God because he has redeemed us. And I think this is exactly what verse 8 is talking about here to close. Shower, O heavens, from above, and let the clouds rain down righteousness. Let the earth open, that salvation and righteousness may bear fruit. Let the earth cause them both to sprout. I, the Lord, have created it. Righteousness and salvation rain down upon the earth to bear fruit. What is that fruit but the glory of God? That God may be magnified in his creation, and that for eternity his people will sing his praises. God is saying in this text, witness my salvation, be certain of my salvation. I will accomplish this redemption. Why? To glorify my name. And this is the foundation of our joy in God. It's the foundation of our confidence in the cross, that God will glorify himself. We can be certain that we will receive redemption, just as Israel could. There is a means by which God accomplishes our redemption. Just as Cyrus was the means of redemption for Israel, so Christ is the means of our redemption. And his work and his righteousness that he's given to us is the means of our redemption. And so also the purpose and the goal of redemption is the glory of God the Father. Let's take a moment just to consider this word from the Lord, and then we'll pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for who you are and that you have revealed yourself to us in your, all of your glory in your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for your word, that we can receive deeper glimpses into who you are and your glory. I pray that this passion for your glory would ignite our praise, Lord, that it would direct what we do and what we say, that it would be about you and not about us. Lord, we pray that as we go through dark times, as we suffer through calamities and evil, that we know that even those things are for your glory. I pray now that as your people go through their daily lives this week, that you would empower them by your Spirit to live holy and pleasing lives. In Jesus' name, amen.